In this video, we're using Gauss's law to compute the electric field inside and outside a long, uniformly charged cylinder. So here's a picture of our cylinder, but I want to make it clear that the calculation here assumes that the cylinder stretches all the way to negative infinity on one end and positive infinity on the other. And we rely on this approximation to conclude that the electric field is exactly radial at every location off the symmetry axis. If this cylinder was finite, it would have fringing effects at its ends, and this makes it so there's not enough symmetry to make use of Gauss's law. So we need our cylinder to technically be infinitely long in order to do the math, and then we view our results as an approximation that's valid when a cylinder is fairly long compared to our distance from the symmetry axis. So we're told this cylinder has a radius of big R and a volume charge density, that's coulombs per cubic meter, that we call rho. And our goals here are to find the electric field inside and outside the cylinder, and then express those results in terms of a linear charge density that we'll call lambda, and that's measured in coulombs per meter along this cylinder. And then finally, we want to get a plot of the electric field magnitude as a function of distance from the symmetry axis. So we start by looking inside the cylinder. So there's our Gaussian surface, a closed cylinder of variable radius little r and length L, where little r is less than big R, the radius of the cylinder. And as always, this Gaussian surface was defined in a way that shares the symmetry of the charge distribution we're studying. So if we pop our electric field into the diagram, the consequence of that symmetry is that the electric field is always perpendicular to the curved surface of our Gaussian cylinder, and the field magnitude is constant along that curved surface since the entire surface lies at exactly the same distance from the symmetry axis. So those are actually the two key points. We need E to be perpendicular to the surface and constant in magnitude, and this is what makes Gauss's law useful. In other words, the electric flux integral becomes trivial. So just writing Gauss's law down real quick, we have the electric flux integral through that closed Gaussian surface is equal to the enclosed charge divided by epsilon zero. And I'll post a link up at the top to where this was first derived. And again, the whole point of Gauss's law is that we can choose a Gaussian surface that makes this flux integral trivial. First, I want to mention that a Gaussian surface must be a closed surface, and that means we do have end caps on this Gaussian cylinder. But along those end caps, the electric field is pointing parallel to the surface itself, so there's no flux through those surfaces. So the first thing I want to say is that our flux integral reduces to just the electric flux through the curved part of the surface, since the flux through those end caps must be zero. And I'll just call that the integral over the curve, in other words, the curved surface of the cylinder of E dotted into dA. Now, secondly, our electric field is perpendicular to that surface at every point, and that means parallel to the area vector, which always points normal to the surface, and that means the dot product is trivial. So when two vectors are parallel, their dot product reduces to just the product of the two magnitudes, and I have the integral of E times dA over the curved part of the cylinder. Now we use the fact that the electric field magnitude is constant over that entire curved surface to factor that E out of the integral. If E is a constant, we can just factor it out in front of the integral, and we end up with E times the integral of dA. Now in the next step, taking the integral of dA just gives us the area of the curved part of this cylindrical surface. And that's simply the circumference, 2 pi r, multiplied by the length, which we use a capital L for. So we end up with E times 2 pi r times L. At the same time, let's go ahead and compute the enclosed charge. The enclosed charge is going to be the volume charge density, that's rho, multiplied by the volume. So I'll just pull my 1 over epsilon 0 out in front, and then I have a rho times the volume of this cylinder. Well, that's just the area of the base times the length. So that's a pi little r squared for the area, and then L for the length. So the L's are going to cancel out. One factor of R cancels out. A pi cancels out. And we just have to divide both sides by 2 here. And we find out that the electric field inside our cylinder is given by rho R over 2 epsilon 0. So there's the electric field inside the cylinder. And toward the end of the video, we're going to rephrase this in terms of linear charge density. But next, we're going to go ahead and get the electric field outside the cylinder. So this time we choose a Gaussian cylinder with a radius little r that's bigger than the radius of the cylinder big R. And again, the electric field points radially outward in this infinite cylinder approximation, making it perpendicular with the curved part of our Gaussian surface. So we invoke Gauss's law a second time. So on the left again is the electric flux integral for that entire Gaussian surface. But remember, the flux through the end caps is going to be zero because E is parallel to those surfaces. So we just have the integral over the curved part. I'll just put a little C down there this time, of E dotted into dA. And again, the electric field is always parallel to the dAs because the area vector points normal to that curved surface. So the dot product is trivial. And by symmetry, the field magnitude along that entire curved surface is going to be a constant number, so we can factor that out of the integral. So I have E times the integral over the curved part of dA. And so the area of that curved part, again, is 2 pi little r times L. And the difference this time is in our enclosed charge. So we don't have a uniform charge density inside our entire Gaussian cylinder, because our cylinder stretches outside the bounds of our actual charge distribution. So this time our enclosed charge, again, that will be charge density times volume. So that's rho times the volume of charge enclosed in here. So our enclosed charge is going to be rho times pi big R squared times L. So pi times big R squared times L is the amount of volume of our actual charged cylinder that was captured inside this Gaussian surface. So a lot of things cancel again. We can cancel an L, we can cancel a pi, and we'll call this one E out. And this cleans up to rho big R squared over 2 epsilon 0 R. All right, so there's the field outside this uniformly charged cylinder. And now we want to relate these two electric fields to the linear charge density. And this is a type of issue that pops up quite a bit when we're solving Gauss's law problems. How do you convert between different types of density? So in this case, we want to convert from a volume charge density to a linear charge density in coulombs per meter. So to get this done, we take a look at our uniformly charged cylinder, and then we highlight a little section of it that has a length of L and a charge of capital Q in it. And all we have to do is write down an expression for this Q in terms of L. So the charge contained in that little section of our uniformly charged cylinder is going to be the volume charge density times the volume, but the volume of that little section is going to be a pi big R squared multiplied by L. And then all we do is divide both sides of this by L, and I end up with Q over L on the left and rho pi R squared on the right. But Q over L is exactly what we're looking for. That's actually lambda, the linear charge density in coulombs per meter. So now if we go ahead and solve for rho, we can plug that into each of our expressions for the electric field and get new expressions in terms of linear charge density, which is actually the more typical way to see these answers in a textbook. So solving for rho, we get lambda over pi r squared, and we'll sub that into E in, and this gives us lambda times little r over pi big R squared times 2 epsilon 0. We can probably write that a little nicer as just lambda r over 2 pi big R squared epsilon 0. Now we do the same thing for E out. Again, just replacing rho with lambda over pi times big R squared. And we end up with a lambda R squared over pi times big R squared times 2 R epsilon 0. So those big R squareds are going to cancel out, and I end up with a lambda divided by 2 pi epsilon 0 little r. So there's our two results for the electric field inside and outside the uniformly charged cylinder and written in terms of the charge per unit length, lambda. And I want to point out that our result for the field outside the uniformly charged cylinder is exactly the same as the result we obtained previously for an infinite line charge. And I'll post a link to that derivation up at the top real quick. But what we're saying here is that if we're outside the cylinder, we can't tell the difference between a charged cylinder field and a line of charge. And this is really similar to what happened when we computed the field of a uniformly charged sphere. Recall that outside the uniformly charged sphere, the field looked exactly the same as the field of a point charge. So finally, we want to get a plot of the field magnitude as a function of distance from the symmetry axis. And we can see that the field inside the cylinder is zero when little r is equal to zero. In other words, when we're right on the symmetry axis of our uniformly charged cylinder. And after that, it increases linearly, so it's just proportional to r. And then we notice outside this cylinder, our field is decreasing like 1 over r. So we have a field that starts at 0 at the center, increases linearly, then we get to the surface of the cylinder, and our field starts to drop off like 1 over r. And there's just one more thing to check before we make a graph. We need to check that this thing is actually continuous at the surface of the cylinder. So if I evaluate En at little r equals big R, in other words, at the surface of the cylinder, that gives me a lambda big R over 2 pi big R squared epsilon 0. And one of those r's is going to cancel, and I get lambda over 2 pi big R epsilon 0 for the magnitude of my field. Now, if I evaluate the outside field at the same location, in other words, letting little r be equal to big R, I end up with lambda over 2 pi epsilon 0 big R. So these two results agree with each other, showing that the field is continuous at that point where we switch rules between the inside field and the outside field. So we wrap it up with a nice sketch of this field magnitude. Again, that's 0 when r is equal to 0. Growing linearly until we get to the surface of the cylinder, and then dropping off like 1 over r when r is greater than the radius of the cylinder. And we can see the function is continuous at the surface of the cylinder. In the next video, we apply Gauss's law to a thick, uniformly charged cylindrical shell with a given inner and outer radius. That video is linked at the upper left if you want to check that out. And my Gauss's Law playlist is linked at the lower left if you're looking for more examples.